Hello everyone, thank you for joining us today. So first, everyone get Wi-Fi, everyone get internet access, that's great. Okay, let's get started. Let me see, why my screen is weird. In the section or after the section, if you guys have any questions, just drop me an email to this address. So we're going to have a break around 3:30.
Yeah.
So during that time, I will try to answer your questions. And if you have questions during the session, you also can just raise your hand and ask me. Okay, let's start. Okay, today we're going to cover a basic introduction, really basic. There's nothing to worry about. And I go by a lot of names. You can call me Kiza, you can call me Chuxin, whatever you want. Yeah. Okay, next. About me, I'm a staff software engineer at BFX IBM Security Division. I'm the technical lead for Linux patching, Mac patching, and BigFix protection. You can see my job scope, it has a lot of to do with security. That's what I do for my day-to-day job. I do coding for living since 2012. So this is the year I graduated from NTU Computer Science. But I actually do coding for love since 2005. Woo! Yes, so I'm 10 years programmer. Okay, let's go to next. That's just a quote from my one of favorite historical character, JFK. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard. I just put it here. The reason I have it here is not because programming is hard. It has its up and down. It's, how to say that? For example, if you guys cook, you know sometimes you just can't get the recipe right. It's similar with programming. The starting point is very easy, but as you go there, and for myself, 10 years in the road, I still think of myself as a learner. There's so much new stuff come out every day. So as you guys, there's no worries. We start with the easy part. Then yourself will go to the hard part. Trust me, you will be there. And you will go in there with your own passion. So no one going to force you to do that. Next, our agenda. Four things, very simple. First, what's a web application? In short, web app. And the second, what's this model view controller thing? We call it MVC. You're going to hear about this thing a lot, like every session in this course. And if you're ever going to become a software developer or product manager or project manager in IT field, you're going to hear this a lot. And next, what's a Ruby and what's a Rails? No worry about here, it's just the question about what the hell is Ruby and what the hell is Rails. Okay. Am I going too fast? I tend to go too fast. Okay. So this is web application by definition on Wikipedia. So based on this definition, I'm not going to read it, you guys are going to read it. My question is, can you guys give me example about web application? Come on, I need someone to answer my question.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I'm going to start with the organizer. Okay, you.
Sorry, I don't know what's the difference between web application and the native application.
And native web application. I'm going to come to there. You're going to, good question. Actually, I have the same question later. For you guys, do you mind? Okay, let's do this. When you guys answer my question, introduce yourself first. So we're going to know each other, not just myself, right?
So I also have a question. Because the thing for this session is using the Ruby on Rails to do the programming.
Yes, yes.
For the web application.
Yes.
But as I know, some people they just use Xcode or Eclipse to do the native applications.
Okay, it's a bit out of the scope of today's session. The quick answer is Eclipse and the Xcode is just a tool for you to use to get there. But however, Xcode is very specific to the Apple technology. And Rails is more general, more generic. And for Ruby, it's even more generic, more general. So I might answer your question or confuse more. OK, you forgot to introduce yourself.
My name is Lucy. I'm a freelance multimedia designer. Yeah.
OK, great. Just add one more thing when you guys introduce yourself. Have you guys do any coding before? Just say yes or no, because I want to get a feel with the experience you have. So, lady over there in the pink coat. Have you do coding before?
No.
So this is brand new to you. Okay, let's continue. My question here, still no one answers. If no one answers, I'm going to punish the organizer. Anyone? Okay, you. Amber, yes. Give me an example of web application.
An application in Google, you know the app, we have.
No, say something everyone knows.
Everyone knows?
Yeah.
Web application?
Yes.
Let me see.
No, oh, come on. No.
Gmail.
Okay, good. So anyone else want to give an example?
WhatsApp. Facebook?
Yes, that's great. Introduce yourself.
Lizette, I'm American, and I just finished Winston's class yesterday.
How is it?
It was great. Okay. It was great. It's more expensive than this class, but Winston is a great teacher.
So your background?
I'm working on a website for a startup of my own.
Oh, that's great.
Website or web app?
Well,
we come to that later. We come to that later. Okay. So anyone want to contribute an answer? If not, I will continue. Let's continue. Okay. Amber over there mentioned Gmail. That's correct. And we also have a Hotmail. So it's two typical, like really popular web application we have out there. And the question comes here: what if I connect my email account to Outlook or to my iPhone Mail app? What does that make? The web application. Because if you go back to the Wikipedia definition, by definition of web application, you have to access your content through a browser, like Safari, like Firefox, like Chrome. But I'm not doing that. So what does that make our mail application here? I'm going to cover this part later. And next, we have social media. Again, Facebook or Twitter. You open your browser, you go there, you check your friends feed. That's great, but what if I use the iOS app or the Android app? What does that make our... Hello there.
Make us
take
a seat.
Web application. Okay.
Are they the same in the front?
Just settle in, I will continue. Okay, so there is no cloud, just other people's computers. The internet, I don't know who said that. I just get it from the internet. So, have you guys heard this term cloud? What does it mean to you? I see someone not looking their head, so.
My name is Sophie.
Mm-hmm.
I learned programming by myself.
So that's great.
For this cloud, it feels like a database
mm-hmm.
online. You save your files online
okay.
rather than in your
hard computer, your own computer.
Yeah.
Okay, so give me an example of cloud.
The Apple, the cloud.
The iCloud? Okay, that's a bit too simple, right? Another example, it has a cloud in the name. It doesn't count, sorry. Yes, iCloud, the Apple iCloud. It has the cloud in the name. It's literally tell you it's a cloud.
Dropbox.
Yes, that's another great example. So this cloud idea actually come out around 2008, Actually, we have been around cloud for a long time. Like Hotmail, like Gmail. You never have physical access to the data you have on your mailbox. It's somewhere. You have no idea. It can be in US, it can be in Singapore. So, what does cloud mean? It actually means you don't need to care about the storage, the hardware, the infrastructure. Am I losing you there? If yes, just raise your hand and ask me to stop, and I'm going to elaborate myself. Okay, so that's the cloud. And the most important part for cloud is normally it's application based. Then it's involved into something more native, as lady over there asked later, just now. What's make an app? So basically, app is just a front end to consume the data from a cloud. Got it? Okay, great. And we have a name for that, we call it web services. Yeah, it's just term software engineers just choke around to impress everyone. But actually it's just cloud, and actually it's just a web application without the browser part. Okay, so no more mystery there for our cloud, right? By the way, so we are building a web application throughout the course. At the end of the day, you will have a web application. But if you just remove the browser part and replace it with, for example, iOS app and Android app, then you actually have a cloud solution. Is that amazing? Okay, that's the basics on the definition part of web application. Anyone have any questions about that? Anyone lost? Still with me, right? Okay.
Just now the outlook example.
Yao, introduce yourself.
My name is Xu Lu, so I graduated from the US information system.
Okay.
But I think it's not a working IT field. So I have a question. Just now you mentioned the outlook application in your
laptop.
Yep. So it's not really through the browser, but it's not really a mobile app. Is it still considered as a web application?
By definition, it's not. But we can call it web services. So when you sign up something, for example, Facebook, you actually sign up the web services Facebook provides. And it just happens it has a nice browser UI for you. So there is a lot of applications actually don't provide that browser view anymore. Give me an example. Who have an example that's a famous app which use a cloud but doesn't have a browser user interface? Come on, everyone.
Slack.
Technically not true. Slack actually have a web browser interface. But it's
WeChat.
WeChat. Yes, that's great. WeChat. You don't have a really open your browser to access your WeChat, right?
You can, but
what? Okay, there is something new every day.
There's a WeChat web. Like WhatsApp web.
Okay.
Is it something similar?
Oh, yeah.
It's different.
Okay. So see, that's make web service great. You, if you want, you can just show a UI there. Then you have web application. Your question?
Actually, for WeChat, it's different. WeChat only has the web browser for the conversation, but to access your friend circle, it could not be accessed through the web.
That part, so, okay. Then you are talking about like the feature you support in each device. You can support a full feature and you can support a sub feature. Okay, let's. Do we have enough discussion on web application? No more questions. If you have, if you guys have the question and too shy to ask me here, can just drop me an email. Okay. Okay. Next part, the MVC. This part, okay, I'm from a computer science background. We have like the 1 whole year course on software engineering. And this guy took us about half a year to understand. So you don't need to understand the definition. It's kind of pointless. That's why I put it, a quote from Wikipedia. But I will just go through that a bit so you can have an understanding. Then I'm going to have a more concrete example so you can have a better understanding. Okay, let's go here. So model, this is a definition. The keyword here is a business logic data. So basically, this one, for example, the lady over there has a startup. Basically, you have some business logic you need to capture in the software. So this business logic should go to this part of MVC, which is called model. And any data, like user account information, transaction information, and my profile photo, password, is going to the model. The reason being is it needs to go to the database. So that's why it's called model. I know you guys must have question about this part. I will come back to this later. Let's go through the definition first. View. This is the easy part. The reason being is anything you can see is go to this part. So for example, if you open a PowerPoint document, then you have this PowerPoint application open up. That thing is the view part. Anything you can feel, you can touch. Oh, that's the view. That's the easy part. Okay? The next part is controllers. This is a hard part. So it's called the coordination layer. What does it do is you have view, you have model. You shouldn't let these two components talk to each other. You should like these two components talk to each other through controllers. Why do we do that? It's a long story. I will give you an example. MVC versus Prada. Okay, so one day you walk into a Prada shop, you have the bags, purse, everything on the shelf, right? So what's that in the MVC part of the world? Yes, correct, that's view. Then something you don't really care. They maybe have a warehouse somewhere, they have an inventory management, they have a point of sales, they have a transaction, they have how to make this design works, they have designers, something most of us don't really care. What's that make in the MVC world? It's the model. For the user, we don't really need to interact with that. So where's the controllers? You go there. You can't just grab something and just leave right. You need to talk to the sales assistant or sales manager, whoever there, help you do the purchase. So his job or her job is to help you interact with the shelf, which is the wheel. You're going to tell him or her which bag you want, which purse you want, and you're going to try it out, and you don't like it, you give it back and ask the salesperson put it back to the shelf. And if you want it, you ask the salesperson continue with the purchase process, which means he's going to ask for your credit card or your money. Then he will complete the transaction for you, then you can have a new bag or purse. So this his job as a controller. Now, do you guys understand what's the MVC now? So it's similar in the web page. For now, as a user, most of the time we only interact with the view part. We don't really care about model or controllers. But actually, when we interact with our view, actually, there is a mini component there. It's the controller to help you complete every single action you do. And at the back end, then the controller will, based on your action, and also update the model part. For example, you create a new account on Gmail, then there will be a controller to add an entry to the database with your login information there. If you create a post on Facebook, again, there's a controller do that for you. And again, at the end of the day, somewhere in the world of cloud, there is a model is updated with your information. So, understand this part now? No more questions for this one? If you have, you can ask now.
What is the difference between the view and the credentials?
Oh, it's the front design. Okay. view is the output of your front design. So we're going to cover UI design and user experience, I think, in two sections. I can't remember the details, but we're going to cover that.
Can I tell you about UI and UX?
Yeah. So anyone here is a designer. Designer, you do graphic design. And okay. So from their point of view, MVC doesn't matter. Actually, from a lot of point of view, MVC doesn't matter. This only matters to the programmers, the engineers. From design, it has two components. One is the graphics, another is the interaction. Graphics basically is the pixels, the colors, the shape of the pictures you want to put there. And another part is the interaction. How are we going to anticipate the user's input? How does the input will respond to our pop-up, something like that? This is the interaction part. And that's the work of a designer. Actually, it's the work of a graphic designer plus a UX designer, which user experience designer. And nowadays, these two jobs is merged together. Because you need to have a great eye to identify, first, what is beautiful, and second is what makes sense to the end user. And here is also where product manager come in, which product manager, who is the owner of the product, he should tell how are we going to do that. And that is his part. So that's the front-end design part. And once the designers have their design, it's pretty much useless until it's going to the development part. People actually convert that into your code. Whatever iOS app, then it's Swift or Objective-C, or front-end, HTML, CSS, JavaScript. It's the engineering part. Then when we come to the engineering part, we care about the MVC. Does this answer your question? I think it's a great question, actually. And I thought of that. So there is a huge difference between this view and our graphic design. Questions?
Is the MVC concept only for
these,
right? It's not for
other languages. No.
Excuse me, can you repeat the question? Because sometimes you can't hear the question.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah, sure. So just now the question, got it?
No.
Okay, so the question is, MVC, is that only for Ruby on Rails or is for everything? Okay, MVC is how to say that? So in software engineering, there is something called design pattern. I don't want to cover that, it's boring. The short answer is MVC is generic. It's applied in the software industry for a long time. It's even before Ruby. Ruby has come out around in the 90s, and we have MVC long time ago. It's just a part of our hardware design. For example, your laptop. You have this graphic part there. It doesn't matter if it's Windows or it's a Mac. It's the graphics. It's just the graphics. You don't really care about the hardware, how it's layered. Then you have this keyboard and mouse, which is the input, sort of like our controller. And actually, it's literally it's the controller. You use that to control your hardware. So MVC concept is has a long history. It's before Ruby and Rails. And another thing, actually, since we have a question like this here, I want to bring up this. Other than MVC, we have like MVVC, MVPC, something, a lot of word, like you have M, V, C, and something else thrown in there. It's just a different company try to come out their own solution to the problem. But actually, everything is just based on this concept. So, even at the end, this whole course, you don't want to use Ruby on Rails. You want to use something new, like Node.js, or you want to use something old, like C#, PHP, Java, whatever. This concept will stuck there. You're going to see it all the time. So you won't just see it in today's course, in the next few courses. You're going to see it in the industry a lot. So far, this MVC pattern, we call it pattern because it's a certain way we do things and we can repeat this thing. So that's why it's called pattern. And MVC pattern so far is the best way to capture our human interaction with a computer. So it's really not necessary for Ruby on Rails. Questions? A lot of questions, so I can give some information. Actually, I know, but I never thought of putting in the slide. I think it's useful for everyone. So if you have questions, don't be shy. Ask here or drop me an email. If it's an interesting question, I'm going to share with the whole class later. OK, then let's continue. OK, Ruby, finally we have the main course here today, Ruby. What is a Ruby? Anyone? I think the organizer sent out an email, asked everyone to complete a book, right? And how many of you actually opened that book? And how many of you actually complete that book? Okay, so where do you guys stop? We're in the book, you guys. For those open the book, where do you guys actually stop?
First page.
Oh, they only have three chapters. Oh, that.
We asked them to read three chapters first.
Sorry, my fault. I saw. Oh, you only asked.
We like at least three chapters. You can do more.
I can't remember what's the first chapter cover about. Never mind. Okay. That should be fine. So,
first chapter is about they also think that Ruby is one of the easiest programming language. He thinks.
Yeah, I know.
So.
Yeah. It depends. So, if you guys ask anyone have like a hardcore background in C, C++, and Java, they're going to tell you Ruby is weird. It's a little weird language. That's true, actually. So, if you guys want to think about switch to other language, here's the warning. It feels different, we'll write Ruby. But about Ruby, is the easiest language for beginner, it's true. It's pretty much more human readable. If you even don't understand everything, you just understand some basics, then you can understand most of the Ruby code. And my personally, I'm from a hardcore background. I do C, C++, and Java, C# stuff like that. And when I first touched on Ruby is, I can't remember, 2000 something, I can't remember. It's weird to me. But besides it's weird, it's still okay, I can understand the code. So it shouldn't be a huge block for you guys. And for those who haven't started on the book, start on the book. It will help you a lot in this course. In today's session, we won't touch on the code that much, so you guys will be fine. Okay, what's a Ruby? Yeah, yet another programming language. We have programming languages come out like every year. If it's not every day or every week, I don't know. Yeah, so it's a language, it's programming language. It's a language you talk to your computers. You're going to tell your computer what to do. Instead of just click on the mouse and the keyboard, you actually ask your computer to do new things. Like you can do something simple like mathematics. You can do plus, minus, multiply, division, those stuff. And then you can do something more advanced like encryption, decryption. And something bad like hacking, black hat hacking, stuff like that. It's a programming language. It's lets you to communicate with your computers. And that's why I put the yes there. Because it's a general purpose language. So you can do it, you can do whatever you want with this language. And for people who heard of, anyone heard of SQL? Okay, that's, we don't call it a general purpose language because it's not a general purpose language. It's for you to communicate with your database. That's it. You can't, actually technically you can use it to do some more fun stuff, but actually that people don't do that. It's just tedious and it won't help a lot. So it covers the basics. Actually, okay, this is a definition more like for the other programming language we have in the world. And Ruby just one of it. Questions about Ruby?
Is CSS and HTML the same language?
Okay, CSS is not a general purpose language. HTML is not a general purpose language. I think we're going to cover it in next course, right? Yep. What is CSS and what is HTML? We're going to cover it in the later course. It's out of this. Anyone have other questions? Or any language have you heard of other than the one I mentioned just now?
What's the difference, or what's the difference of Ruby and Rails, or why they are used together?
I'm going to come to that later. Did you there have a question?
Oh yeah. Can you tell me the difference between
Android.js,
Python, something you're hearing
in
Python a lot?
Oh, Python and Ruby. Python is also yet another programming language. It's a general purpose programming language. The difference is, let's put it that way. What's the difference between English and the Mandarin Chinese? It's the same. You're asking about the similar questions. So, okay, let's play with the mic. So, do I need to use this?
Yes.
Okay. This sounds weird.
Sexy. Okay. Yeah. Don't say that. It's come out wrong. So, what's the difference between Python and Ruby? It's like in the world we have so many different human language. We have Chinese, English, we have Japanese, we have Korean, we have Russian, recently I have a colleagues actually from Finland. They have their own language. So it's not a surprise. everyone from different country, different world, we speak different language. Even in China, there's a lot of different languages. It's same in the computer world. Another day, I was talking to Amber, the organizer over here. I said, technically Ruby is a Japanese. Yes, anyone know why I said that? Because the creator of Ruby is a Japanese guy. Yes, yeah. So, it's just a different language. So there's not really much of surprise there. But each language, they have own strengths. Ruby, because of Ruby on Rails, a lot of programmers come to Ruby is because of web application. But for people doing data scientist, doing data science, doing big data, doing data analytics, they choose Python because there is a new Py library sort of thing. So there's a tool from Python. It's make the work you do easier. That's why people are choosing different language. For example, I use Mac a lot. So I probably won't use C Sharp. The reason being is C Sharp is from Microsoft, which is running on Windows only for quite a long time. And recently they ported it to Mac. Different story. Anyway, I tend to drift away, sorry. Yeah. Answer your question? And your question, I'm going to answer you later. So the question is, what's the relationship between Ruby and Rails? The relationship is Ruby is the actual language. Rails is a framework. When I say framework, it's more like a tool. It just happened to written in this language. So let me think of something that can make the thing easier for you guys to understand.
Can I try?
Yes, sure.
Sure. So like in programming languages, there are many ways of doing things, right? And sometimes some smart people have thought about very ingenious way of solving some problems. And the way that they kind of solve problems is write a bunch of code and then make it available for others to use. So a programming framework is kind of like a collection of programs that smart people has put together that solves certain problems. And sometimes they call it a library. And a collection of so a bunch of code that does solve some problems are grouped together and you call them libraries that you can use. And a bunch of these libraries all put together, like say this one does certain things, this bunch of libraries solve certain problems. So all these grouped together to form what we call a framework, which is a collection of a bunch of small little softwares that solve certain problems, but they all group together to help you solve a bigger problem. Right? In this case, Ruby on Rails is to help you build a website. Right? So the website needs to build to serve pages, needs to connect to a database, it needs to get data. Needs to be able to render your style sheets and all that stuff. These are small little problems, right? These are small little problems that need to do Ruby solve, and there are small little pieces of Ruby code that fixes all this. And all these are grouped together into a framework which lets you use it. And then for you to use it, you have to write in a certain way, which is the Rails way of doing things, which we'll show you guys later, hopefully. Yeah, so does that answer the question? Better understanding? Yeah.
Oh, you guys are more lost. So
are you more lost?
Not yet.
So you still don't get it?
Yeah, okay.
Let's think of this way. Let's think of this way. Yeah, that's a hard part. Actually, this is a hard part in introduce technology to beginners. Because we used to understand like framework, library, language, this concept. For example, you want write an article, French movie in French. So, first, you need know French language, right? Second, you need to research on French movie. What do you do?
you go to libraries, you go to video store, you go to rent these great French movies and watch it, and use your French language to write this paper.
So which part is Ruby and which part?
So the French is the Ruby, it's the language. And the library, the resources you borrow from, it can be the real. It can be. So, I think I'm going to have a slide on Jan. Never mind. So, reals can be one of the. So, back to college, when I do research, normally I will pick field paper, which I feel is most important. I'm going to address these papers in my paper as a reference. Real is something like that. It serves as a baseline to your application. You guys seem confused.
Yes.
Yes.
So, Fred, when I understood this concept between what real is and what new is, at a very basic level, you can think of this, right? Let's say that you want to, like, if you're a child and you want to, like, build a house, make a house that drawing or whatever. Assume that you're just having many lines, you have like a box with many lines inside. So if you want to build a house with the lines, it would be like adding the lines and turning the lines into a chimney or something. You just have lines. No, so now someone comes in and says, okay, these lines are very basic. I already made these lines into some little shapes, like circles and squares and stuff. And I'll give you another box with these shapes, so that you have, it's easier for you. You don't need to make those lines into those basic shapes. So you understand this? So the basic line is Ruby. Rails is someone actually taking Ruby into some most used concept and converting it into a library, so that you guys can just use that instead of doing the same conversion again. That's basically the difference. That's it. Ruby is a very basic core of nothing, you can just do anything with it. Mm-hmm. Rails is some abstraction over it, some shapes built over it, that is for you to use, that is to make your life easier. You don't need Rails to use Ruby. You can just choose to use the lines and do whatever you want. But if you want to do it fast, why would you do it? So that's the point. Is it clear?
Yeah.
Or have a confusion?
Yeah. Audience. Okay, cool. You guys probably going to hear stuff like libraries, Jam, Ruby Jam, a lot. You're gonna get used to it. Let's put it that way. Yeah. Okay. Let's continue. Okay. So, yeah, just a bit more. So let's talk to your computer in Ruby. First, you need to teach your computer Ruby. Amber, did you send out the instruction on how to set up Ruby on the laptop?
No, I
saw
you.
Okay, yes, yeah. So, no, I just check it. So, I think we're still going to send out. So, this part, we're going to cover teach your computer Ruby. Basically, you're going to install Ruby on your computer. For those with Mac, you actually already have it. But it's normally the older version. For those with Windows, unfortunately, there is no easy way to... Actually, it's pretty easy to do that. We can send the information to you guys. Yeah. And the second part is you need to teach yourself Ruby. That's the hard part. And the last, practice and a lot. Okay? I won't talk too much about Ruby today. Actually, I talk a lot. Okay, next one. This is a book I mentioned, Learn to Program. And by this guy. It's not the Star Trek guy. Okay, I only see guys is laughing. Okay. Anyway, if you Google this guy, it probably come up wrong. Anyway, there's a URL for the book. For those start to read, it's great. For those haven't, please go to read it if you have time. It's a really interesting book. Just a bit more about this book. It's quite old. It's cover Ruby 1.8, but you get the concept. And second, in the book, this author try to remove all the confusing parts of a new language, like data type variables, data structure. Do you guys even understand the half thing I'm talking about? Just not. So, this book is really great. It covers from a really, beginning part of the video. So, it won't mention a lot of the concept, but it will mention it at the end of the chapter, each chapter. So, which means you can get a start. Then you can go back and visit and understand what's going on. Okay? It's a great book. Some key part in the book you need to pay attention to. Since most of you haven't read this book, I think this looks pretty alien to you, right? Okay, so actually for this part, I said Ruby 101, right? If you change this Ruby to anything else, it's still true. You can just change it. We're going to send the PPT to you, I'm sure, so no need to take a photo.
Yeah.
So, if you change the Ruby to PHP, to some language we just mentioned, the Java, C Sharp, it's still true. It will get you start with any language, just follow this structure. And this is how that book, the book I mentioned just now, this guy, it's written. So, it's a great book. Yeah, just pay attention to these keywords, then you'll be okay. Okay, we actually going to do coding today. Maybe you can take a short break now.
So, in the break, I had a great question. Someone is asking, who use Rails in the real production world? So here is some examples. First is Twitter. So Twitter probably is one of the most famous one. And it's going down the Basecamp. Who heard about these guys? Basecamp. You, anyone else? Yeah, of course you. Okay, Rails, Ruby on Rails actually came from these guys. Ruby on Rails is the fundamental part of Basecamp, and those guys, they decide it's a such great tool, we should make it free for everyone. So that's why today we can have Ruby on Rails for free for everyone, do whatever we want. So Basecamp. And next guys, Yellow Pages. Yeah, I'm not really interested in that. Hulu. Hulu, the guys doing videos, and okay, this guy not really, GitHub. Have you guys attend our early section on GitHub?
Some of them.
Yeah, some of them. I thought you guys lost. Okay, anyway, GitHub. Actually, it's just their front end, the user management part is using Rails. Let's move down Shopify. I think they provide a framework itself. Ah, Coupon. Coupon also uses them. Airbnb.
The whole site is built on Rails. The whole site is built on Rails.
When we say someone using Ruby on Rails, normally we only referring to some components. Those sites you see here, they are massive. It's impossible for them to do the whole thing with a single tool. If you go up a lot, top left, let me do the top left. This guy. Twitter, actually it's mentioned in the early days. The reason being is, a few years ago, if you remember, Twitter has a serious downtime. is because of some performance issues in Ruby on Rails. So actually Twitter is still using some components from Ruby on Rails, but not the whole thing. And another example is not here, it's LinkedIn. LinkedIn, the whole thing is built on Ruby on Rails for a few years. And they was running on 21 plus servers. I can't remember the exact numbers. And a few years back, there is something new come up. It's called Node.js. And LinkedIn feel it's a great technology and they want to try it. The end result is amazing. What they did is, you know, in LinkedIn, you have a push notification, you have real-time communication, and your news feed is just keep updating, right, with the number there. It's a real-time communication technology. And they decide to replace that part with Node.js. And the end result is 20 plus server down to 2 or 3, I can't remember, and half of the server is redundant, which means they are backup. Just in case the main server is down, you can have a secondary server to switch over. But LinkedIn still, major of their business logic is written in Ruby, and it's running on Ruby on Rails. So there's no single answer to all the questions. But why we start Rails? Obvious reason, it's a great start point for all the applications. It don't really matters until you grow into like have millions of users online all the time. Then you have problem with some layer of the Ruby on Rails. Then you move it out. Questions? Okay, if not, let's continue with our some coding. Okay, Cloud9. Have you guys opened an account with this guy? So log in please. Everyone log in. I think I will just skip the PowerPoint since I'm going to do the exactly same thing you guys are doing. Okay. Yeah. So this is your dashboard. It's a bit messy. Let me add something. So do you guys create a workspace yet? If not, okay, let's go to how to create a workspace. Why have this guy here? Okay, never mind. Okay, so let's. Okay, sorry, my audio is a bit off. Let's do this. So, I should cover this earlier. So, what's next with Ruby? This is true for all the programming languages. So, their structure, algorithm, OOP design, and Ruby gems. I will come to the Ruby gems later. The first two. You don't need to know what the hell is that yet. If you are interested, you can just do a quick Google search and get the definition somewhere and look through some examples, then you know. But it's really important for you have a deeper understanding about this technology. One thing, in the long run, we don't just want you guys know how to use it. We also want you guys to understand how this tool works. So someday, yourself might come up a new tool or modify this existing tool. Okay, so what's a Ruby gem? If you guys remember, in the first half of the session, we mentioned something like libraries. We mentioned a lot of times libraries. And in Ruby, we give this library in a name. In terms of library, we call them gem. So what does a gem mean? It means you have something you want to do. For example, okay, you want to make a dish, and you get some vegetables and meat. Next thing, you need to cut them into pieces. So what do you need? You need a knife, kitchen knife. So where do you get the kitchen knife? You go to the shops, you buy one. You won't take out some iron and make one knife, right? Similar idea here. We don't really need to make all those tools we want to use. It's available out there. And Ruby on Rails actually is a collection of these tools. So Ruby on Rails itself is a gem. It's a gem, and actually it's also a collection of gem. So basically it's a bunch of tools bundled together for you to use. And what's a Ruby gem for? When you do something, you want to keep track what you are using. For example, you have a recipe for a dish, and you use some pepper, you use some salt, you use some meat, you use some vegetables, and spice, seasoning. And you want to keep track what you are using. And it's called recipe. It's similar here. You want to list down the list of gem you are using for your application. So that's why we have this gem part here. The reason being for this gem file is, for example, I'm working on that, and someday later, I decide I should probably retire and hire a new guy to do that. He doesn't need to figure out what the tools I'm using by himself. I have this file. It's more like a recipe. He just can take over and use it. Questions? No? Okay. I'm not sure why I'm here. Okay, yeah.
Sorry.
Okay.
So the Ruby gem file is like part of the Ruby gem. Or Ruby gem?
Okay, this gem file I'm referring to is at application level and program level. Technically, each Ruby gem, they have a list of files. This gem is using, it's called dependency. It's sort of like a gem for itself. It's a very good question. And do you guys have an idea? So guys, okay, the question is, does Ruby gem itself has a Ruby gem file in it? Technically, yes. But here, we are not going to cover that. Okay, and let me check with Michael. Do you make gem for yourself? Gem library?
Yes, I have.
Then how often do you do that?
Once in... I've been doing Ruby for 2 years, I only done it once. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
And as a new programmer, to Ruby on Rails, do you do that?
No, I don't think so. No.
So, you get the answer right. But the Ruby gem file on the project base, we're going to use that a lot. So, questions? No questions? Okay, I will continue. Okay, Rails, two concepts here. Web application framework. We can change this framework into a library, or more like a cooking book, instead of a single recipe. It provides everything you need to prepare a wonderful dinner. So this wonderful dinner is your web application. And the next one, conventional work of okay, anyone knows what's the configuration? Nice.
Is it like function? Is it like the a structure you put the...
Let's change that now. Wait. Anyone know what's a setting is? I have an iPhone. So configuration is more like a setting setup. You provide some settings in your application and let the application decide to do certain things in a certain way. How to say? It's more like I'm using the cooking again. So when you do some grill a steak, you need to have some control over the temperature. And this is called configuration. But for example, when you go into a restaurant, you're going to order a steak. You probably will say, I want my steak to be well done, medium well, right? You won't say, I want my steak be cooked with this particular temperature, with this particular length of time, right? So that's a convention. Well done is a convention. Time, temperature, those technical details is configuration. Now you guys get it, right? So, convention over configuration. In Rails, we follow convention. It provides ways to do configurations, but we just tend to not do it. When you say something in Rails, you intend to do something. It's fixed. It's like order a steak in a steakhouse. Questions? Okay, great. Oh, I got the order wrong. Sorry. Okay, so let's back to our Cloud9 interface.
What?
Okay. Never mind. Okay, so first, create a new space, a workspace. It's just a term. It's more like a project. So you need to give a name to it. I will just call it anything. And then the next part is this is private and public. It don't really matter here. And since you guys only have a free account, so which means you only have one private project and as many as public project you want. So choose a template. Okay, I'm going to just do some introduction here. If you choose this guy, Ruby, and you can see a Rails logo here, it will set up the whole Ruby on Rails project for you. But in this course, the purpose for this course, we're going to let you guys set up project yourself. So please choose this one, Rails tutorial. Anyone doing that? Okay, let's create.
You did it wrong, you can just create new workspace.
Yes.
Just follow up. Rails tutorial or just Rails test.
Anyone got to here? Anyone have difficulty to get here?
Yeah, I think it's Rails tutorial.
Yeah.
If you have questions, do raise up your hands so this can help. Thank you.
Okay, anyone have any difficulty to get to this part?
You can just raise your hands.
Yes,
we have
yes.
Six tutors here, so they will just come to you. Just raise your hands.
Yeah, your workspace need to have this space.
You can continue.
Okay, let's continue. Okay, so
Oh. Okay, so next, we're going to make a new Rails project. So if if you guys ever going to set up a Ruby on Rails environment on your own laptop, there will be additional step before this one, because in our Cloud9 environment, the whole thing is pre-configured for you to use Ruby on Rails. And for if you guys want to set up a Ruby on Rails environment yourself on your own laptop, talk to Amber. She has the instruction. Yes. Amber, please raise your hands just in case no one knows you. Say hi. Okay, never mind. That's, oh, you guys know who is Amber is, right?
Yes.
Okay. So for Ruby on Rails, one thing, another thing is very important is command line. You guys need to get used to do stuff with command line. On Mac, it's called terminal. It's here. If you go to Spotlight and you type terminal, then it's here. It is. Yeah. And on Windows, it's called some CMD, I think. I don't. Yeah. So it's similar. The command we're going to use for Rails project is almost the same. So you guys should be fine. Okay. Let's continue with create a new project. So this is the command you're going to type in here, this part. This is your terminal. So just don't do anything yet. If you go to this type and right click, okay, here, this plus sign, and you can see new terminal. So this is an actual terminal. And for those...
Could you repeat? Sorry, I didn't get it.
Okay, yeah, before I do that. So, one question. Anyone use Linux before? Linux, oh, okay, sorry. Okay. This thing, we call the shell or terminal, is another way for you to interact with your computer instead of keyboard and mouse. Anyway, still use mouse, but you key in the command here and it will do stuff. For example, I can do ls. What does it mean? Actually, it's short for list. Okay? So, as I said, this is the actual shell. Is that okay? You guys should see exactly what I'm seeing here. So, I how to do things.
Both view font size increase. Command plus to increase the font size. Command plus.
Yes.
Shift.
Do I need your shift?
No.
Okay. Cannot. Okay.
Oh no.
Let me change the resolution. I think the dot is a hidden file or folder. So this guy is supposed to be hidden. I think I changed some configuration long time ago. You guys can ignore it for now. We're going to need it later, okay? Okay, so let's do this. Can you see this? Okay, so everyone, you guys can do a PWD first. Just key in PWD and key enter. We're going to have a lot of conversation about PWD. So basically, it's going to give you the current directory or folder you are working on from this terminal. Okay, so let me see, what do we have here? PWD, okay, yeah. So you can see it's a Ubuntu workspace. And that tells a lot. The backend of this application is running on Ubuntu. If you are not sure what's that, it's okay. Yeah. So let's create a real project. So here is the command. Real space new space project name. Try not to use any space in your project name. The reason being is it confuses the computer. So in my case, I do Rails new my app. You can do any name you want, but I will suggest everyone just stay the same. You're going to see this. It's doing a lot of stuff for you. Rails new my project.
I think you can continue if they don't write.
Yeah. Anyone not following? I saw everyone is busy doing something. Someone is busy doing something. Got it? Got it?
Just keep going.
The guy on the phone, got it? Okay, good. Oh, actually, we're still going to wait. So see, it's doing something for us. Yeah, so let's continue with this part of work. For people have this line, bundle install, eyes on me. Oh, questions? Okay, eyes on me. Okay, so look at this part. You're going to see your new project folder here. Right?
Yes.
Yes.
Just open up. Take a quick look. It's a long list of files and a sex to real. You don't need to do anything and you got there already. So you can see it's creating a lot of stuff, right? And then it's doing bundle install. And do you guys still remember the file I mentioned, the Ruby gem file? Look at here. Okay, the one I highlighted. Open, double click. So you will see it pop up here, which is the editor. Okay. So you're going to edit your file here. This is the part you can change your code, write your code. Okay? So let's see something interesting. First line is the source. It's where your Ruby going to get the gem it needs. And what's the gem file it needs? It's here, it's a list here. So you have gem, Rails, follow its version number. Gem, another gem file, no version number. So which means it's not really important. And some other weird stuff, yeah. Going on here, I won't cover here today, it's not really necessary for us today. But just say, for example, this one, you can take a guess. Anything, So it's uglify. Yeah, I'm going to cover that. No, I'm going to not cover that. So uglifier. So anything is newer than 1.3.0 is okay. And this is a Mac convention, so it means the minor version doesn't count. So let's go down.
CoffeeScript,
you seriously want me go there today?
I'm just curious, what is that?
Okay.
JavaScript or is...
Okay, anyone heard of JavaScript? I think everyone, yeah. So, another name for it is called MEC script, is that correct? I can't remember.
ECMAScript.
Yeah.
And
what?
ECMAScript.
Yeah, repeat that loud. Yes, so that is the official name for JavaScript.
What ECM?
Yeah, so, and the CoffeeScript. Okay, anyone heard of Java? Okay, so proud. Okay, Java has nothing to do with the JavaScript. So don't confuse these two, even they share the same similar name, yeah. CoffeeScript is something someone to wrote to... Okay, you use CoffeeScript to output a JavaScript.
Someone thought that JavaScript was really hard to program in.
Yes.
So someone thought, okay, let me just make a small improvement to a programming language.
Which? Called CoffeeScript. Basically, CoffeeScript is just way of writing JavaScript. So instead of saying, A equal to B. Someone thought A equal to B is really ugly. So let me just say A is B in English, for example. That is CoffeeScript. CoffeeScript is an improvement on JavaScript. Basically, it just converts whatever you write in CoffeeScript into JavaScript. Because only JavaScript can be understood by the computer. You understand? So JavaScript is a language. It's a base language that your browser understands, your Chrome or your Internet Explorer. That is, if you want to write something for your browser, you write in JavaScript. But JavaScript as a language is a little ugly according to some people to write. It's very hard to understand and all that. So someone made it neater. So basically that language is CoffeeScript and it converts to JavaScript. That's it. There is no importance to it. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
So CoffeeScript is the way that you can write JavaScript. And
it's one way of use not wanting to write JavaScript, but you have to write JavaScript. If you're really stuck in that position to write JavaScript, but you don't like it,
you just have less coding graces.
Yeah. No. Actually, my personal view on this: if you really hate JavaScript, just try TypeScript.
It's
go
like away. Another CoffeeScript.
Evil person. Go
no,
away.
I support. I stay strong with my TypeScript. Anyway.
Blasphemy.
Yeah. So since. Someone mentioned about CoffeeScript, and we have this guy here too. Yeah, so basically is another way to write CSS. So just something make everything more confusing, so I'm not going to come there. Okay, this is the gem file, and you can see we have a different group. This. I really shouldn't cover this. So, okay, yeah. So basically, it tells the way you do deployment. Okay.
Embarrassing.
Yeah. So basically, test, deployment, and the development. You can use different set of gems for different scenario. So this basically was this for. Anyway, is our cursor back for everyone? Check your screen, please. Yeah. Okay. So it has some information that it's installing something, and just make sure no one has errors. It should be fine for Cloud9 user. If you're going to use your own setup, you might see error here. Yeah, so Thus, we need to deal separately. But for now, we are okay, I think, for everyone, right? No errors, right? Okay. Believe or not, we already have a running application. I'm going to show you. Ah, come on. Okay, yeah. Ah, almost, okay. Okay. So, let's move to next bash command. It's just a fancy name for this stuff. CD stands for change directory, which means change folder in your terminal. Remember, we just create a new application with a new name and a new folder, right? So let's do this. Okay, first let's do ls. Oh, sorry. Oh yeah.
Hi, can I ask a question?
Yes.
Why when we create this project, we have so many folders on the left?
I will come to that later.
Okay, sure.
Okay. So, just you curious. This part, not really important, this guy app, if you open it, you will see controller model wheels. Our MVC is back. So we're going to talk about this a lot, right? Okay, let's do ls first, least terminal. You're going to see your application name here, right? Okay, let's do thing. Change the directory into your application, which means, oops, sorry, cd and my app. The end step doesn't really matter, so we can do this.
That's it.
Yes, and after this, just hit enter. Then you can see. Anyone got it? Questions? If okay, then I will continue. Let's do ls. Everyone got the CD part, right? And any feedback?
Yeah.
This part. Okay, I assume everyone is done here. So if you do a list, then you can see the content here is the same as your content here under your folder. Okay? So why this CD is important? From this point onwards, everything we do from this folder directory, your project directory. So if for example, next week you come back, some command doesn't work. First thing you need to check, am I in the right directory? One way to check is PWD. I think it stands for present working directory, something like that. Yeah, so PWD. Then it will give you the full path to your current folder your cursor is at, which in my case is also my application folder. So make sure you are in this folder all the time. Everyone got it? Okay. Let's move on. The fun part. We already have application. We can actually run it. So, how do we run this application? First, make sure you are in your application folder. Second, don't do anything yet. I'm going to introduce the command first. Rails s. This s stands for server. Actually, you can use server instead of s, but we just use a shorthand. And you can use some options. if you're doing development on your own laptop, this first part is sufficient enough. But since we're in Cloud9, Cloud9 needs to do some crazy stuff for us so we can see it in our browser. So this is the command you need to type in your shell, terminal, command line, whatever. So do this. Rails space S dash P stands for port number. Then you provide the this dollar sign port space dash B space dollar sign, yeah, dollar sign. Just do this first. I'm going to explain what's the dollar sign for. Okay. Who remember what's dash B stand for?
Binding.
Oh, binding. Binding IP address, yeah. Thank you.
Can you switch to the slides?
Yep.
So the letters are bigger.
Just don't hit enter here. Just stop there. If you hit it, it's okay. Okay. Yeah, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Yeah. No, it's okay. It won't delete anything, it won't mess up your project. Okay, let's. I'm going to explain a bit on this dollar sign. It's a bash variable. So, if you don't understand that, it's okay. Just, it's something extra we need to do for Cloud9. If you're doing it on your own laptop, you don't need the last part, you just do the first part. That's it. Yeah, so let's go to hit the enter. Yes, so this part. So everyone have your own link. And everyone can see your own page, right? Don't use my URL, use your own. Okay, what? Let's do it. Okay, let's kill this. Okay. This will kill your application and just what we run. You need a space. It won't work. Okay, something I noticed, okay, just now? So for example, I want to move my cursor around. You know, you see this guy. It should be blinking. Why it's not blinking? Okay. So this white guy. I want to move it somewhere else. Don't use your mouse to click on it, it won't work.
Preview.
What preview?
Coming
up
next to run, you can click preview.
Okay.
Preview running up.
Ah, you also can do that.
Yeah,
it
appear on the bottom right
button.
But it looks different.
And then you cannot run.
Why yours is so?
Oh, mine is not running.
Oops.
Yeah. And anyway, so I just cue it. And then all right. Yeah. So let's go back to the cursor part. So don't use your mouse, try to move it around, it won't work. You need to use your arrow key. So for example, if I want to have extra space, I need to use the arrow key here, and if I need to remove the thing, just use the arrow key. And for example, I want to repeat some command I enter earlier. There's a quick way to do that. Use arrow key up and down. It will have a list of the command you have used earlier. Okay? So everyone got their application running. So I can continue.
Yeah, continue.
Someone have some questions here? Do you have questions? No, okay. Okay. This part, let's go back to our terminal. This is the log come from your real application. For example, you can see here something for this guy. This is the IP address your server is running on, and they have a timestamp here. And this little guy here is actually referring to your root directory, which means is basically is your URL without anything attached behind. For example, I have the Coding Girl web page here. If this thing going to real log, it probably will see is get slash groups slash at this number over there. So from the log, you actually can see what the application is doing. And yeah, that's pretty much. And you have 200 OK. It literally means OK. Means no error, no bug, no whatsoever at this point. Okay? And you actually have a control over this value. We're going to come to that in the future sessions. So next thing, we're going to kill this application. Yes, yeah, we're going to do that, sorry. So if, see here, control C to shut down server. Now, it doesn't matter you are using Mac or Windows, just do control C at the same time. Actually, why I do it, I press control first, then press C. Everyone do that, please. Okay, then go to your web page and do a refresh. It's gone. Yeah. We're going to get it back, trust me. Okay, let me see what's the next thing I'm supposed to do. Okay, yeah, actually I have this one. Okay, we go through this. Oh, I need to go through the application folders. Yeah. Let's go through the application folders. So, for today, I'm only going to focus on, this guy. The app folder. It's organize your application components. It's got some subdirectories. Yeah. It's pretty boring. It's just a folder. But it has the key ideas for your application. So I think I'm going through the wheel and the controller and model separately. So first model. Do you remember in the early half I mentioned MVC? This model is exactly the same as the model I mentioned earlier. It's talked to your database. It's supposedly to have your business logic. Why do I say supposedly? I'm going to, yeah. So the reason I say supposedly is where we put the logic is up to the programmer itself. It's not necessary that everything should be here and something else must be there. It's not that. As a programmer, we have this power to decide where our logic goes, but for the best, we should put our business logic here. Okay? Next, view component. Again, it's exactly the same as I mentioned earlier in our MVC, but you can see, actually, view in the real world is doing more than presenting. It do a lot of stuff. It's filling data for the application in a template. It converts this thing into HTML and let you to see it in the browser. Yeah, of course it needs send the data to the browser first. So in the earlier session, I said MVC view is only the presentation part. It's kind of an understatement. It's doing a lot of stuff. And view, actually, you can write in Ruby code in it. Which means you actually can get stuff from model to view. So, as I said again, do not do that. For the best, just keep the view where it belongs to. But sometimes the logic can be fuzzy. It's hard to tell which part is going to where. It's okay. You're going to figure out in a long time. After you're doing one or two applications on your own, then you have a good feel which logic should go in where. Okay? Controller. It's the middleman. So, yeah, okay, there's nothing much to talk about for controller. It's, next session, we're going to have a more detailed discussion on what controller does, and you're going to have a new concept like ROS and stuff like that. I won't talk about that today. So, just remember, all the link you click in your application, it needs to go to controller. It's because controller is the middleman, and the link actually is the middle. It's the way the middleman gets the information. Okay? So any questions about our, again, MVC, but now it's really specific to our Rails. No questions? Okay, that's great.
What does SS
mean? Ah, asset. This guy? If you open it, you can see image JavaScript style sheet. So, someone want to, Mike, you want to explain what the SM means here in this concept? We have a question about what the SM means.
So you understand what a view controller model mean, right? So you're clear with that. Okay. So what an asset means is basically it's something like when you look at when you open the server now, you see Rails welcomes you and all that stuff, right? You see many images and a lot of text and all that. So this layout is rendered by something called as HTML. So So that is how you say the image should be here. This image can be found here and all that stuff. So those are the assets. And assets, the assets list is basically something that your server is telling the browser a list of stuff that you need to show that helps. It can be images, it can be styles, it can be text or whatever, it can be HTML. So all of these, in a very simple term, it's an asset. They have a separate folder for it because, one, it's easier to manage. Like for example, if you have some icons that you want, you can just put it in the folder. And you can, then in the app, you can be like, oh, just go to assets folder and look for this icon. Then show it there, right? So it's easier to manage. And one more thing is that it's easier to compress it. So it's in one folder. When you're actually calling for a web page to the server, you need to call the server, get all the images information to your computer, then it's shown to you, right? That's how the entire process works. So this takes a very long time. So if it's all in one folder, then you can compress all of these into one small file so that it's very fast to come back and you can separate it and show. That's the assets folder in a very simple way. Yeah.
So why don't they keep it in the views?
So assets, so the Rails convention is that views only handles HTML stuff. Assets are more like images and stuff that is behind the HTML running. This is a convention. Many different languages follow different conventions for these. So in Rails, because it makes it, Rails loves cleanness in the code. If you put images, JavaScript, and everything into your views, it clutters it and it confuses people. But instead, if it's just the HTML in the view, it's much neater. And yeah.
So in other words,
they
can assess people
out front and the codes and the images. Yes, you could say that, yeah. The HTML would be located in the views. You can see that JavaScript, images, style sheets are all located in a sense. This is just a convention, this is a Rails convention, that's it. So when you're coding in some other language or even in Rails, you per se don't need to follow this convention for you. But it is better to follow it so that anyone else who's reading your code knows where to look for it. Any other doubts?
Hello. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, so.
Let's work on the exercise.
Yeah, let's do that. So. Assets, I think we have a chapter on that, and it has something to do with asset pipeline. So, as he mentioned just now, it's going to compose stuff into one. And the reason behind that actually is come from HTTP limitation. So, yeah, that don't talk about it. Okay, so next, we're going to create a static page. Public folder. Let's skip that. So, okay, anyway, let's do this. Public folder, it's public, which means anything under this folder can be accessed directly. Like some error page. You can see here, if you open your public folder, you have 404, which means page not found, 500, which means internal error, and something else. So, now I'm going to do is create a hi page. I'm not going to create a hello world, just everyone doing hello world. I'm not going to do that. Yeah, so let's do this. Right click on your public folder. And where's my new file? Yeah, new file. Okay. Change the name to hi HTML. So today, technically, I'm not going to write an HTML file. I will just write a text file, but let's give the name HTML. Open it. Let's do hi Rails. And remember to save your file. Okay, everyone get it?
Yes.
So again, first, make sure you are under your application folder. It's just for the beginning. Later you will get to use it, you know where you are. So let's try something interesting. I will do this. Okay, I will. Double dot means going to the parent folder. I will run my application there. You guys don't do that. Just going to give you an error. So you see, it's going to a bunch of errors. The reason being is I'm running this command outside my application folder. So the reason every time I ask you guys to check where are you is because I don't want you guys to see the error, but I think you guys should see it. Then you know why we need to stay in our application folder. Okay? So let's run your application. If you finish with your hi.html documents, remember to save it. Okay, you should add this page now. So you need to create a hi.html file in your public folder, then save it. I mean, write something in it, then save it. So my case says hi Rails, and you can see anything you want. Then run your application and open your application. Everyone should add this page.
Yeah.
Questions? So next will be the interesting part. So, go to your URL and add a slash and hi.xml over there. And then you can see the content you put in your HTML file. Anyone?
Excuse me, can you put the code to start the server again?
Okay, yeah.
You can use
up error. So the code is the code is here. Rails.
I have a question.
Okay.
If I'm already running my application and now I change it to HTML again and I save it, do I need to run it again?
I don't think so. You should let me think. It shouldn't. Okay, if your application is still running, you don't need to restart your server to see this page. But, okay.
Is it only for cloud or if we do it on localhost, do we need to?
You don't need. For this particular case, you don't need. But for sometimes, we do need to restart the server. For example, a routing table. I mean, we have a route. If you're updating that page, you need to reset your. We will cover that later. It's too much information for now. So everyone, okay, let's get back here. Everyone gets to this page already. So go to your URL, and at the end of it, type slash hi. HTML and key enter. Then the stuff you just put in your hi.xml file is come back. This is a static page. What does it mean? It means it doesn't consume any data from the backend. is always the same, regardless of what you have in the backend. And this actually is the part you don't actually need the Rails. But we just have it because just in case you need that, and it's really simple to start. Okay, everyone got it? Question? You seriously? Okay, who knows what's the back end, what's the front end? Who knows? Okay, you guys are knows. So who doesn't know what's the back end, what's the front end? No one raised their hand, so which means everyone knows, right? Okay. Back end, front end. So everything the user can see. Let's put it, it's not technical right. I don't think it's technical right, but let's put it that way. Everything normal user can see is the front end. Everything else is the back end. And let's be more specific. For example, in this case, it's an HTML page, and if I do view source, it have some. Where's my source? Oh no, this is the source. If I do inspect. And I should have a bunch of resources. No, where's my resources? So if I go here, you see there's a bunch of stuff. You have cookies, sessions, whatever, and it should where's my JavaScript? Never mind, I didn't put JavaScript anyway. So you're probably gonna see CSS, JavaScript, a bunch of stuff here. Does it consider as front end or back end? It's something that normal user can't see. But we still call it front end. The reason being is those guys are responsible for the display of data and the interaction between the user. So this is the front end. And back end is something the user won't see it at all. So for example, these guys, you still can see it in your browser. But backend code is just completely shielded from the front-end user. Ah, better definition. Front-end is the code running in the user's and the user's computer. Backend is the code running on the server. Okay, is that clear everything? Why we mention this? What do we ask this question? Okay, anyway, so you have this static page here. And I think one of the tasks for you guys is going to create some static page, right?
My page is very nice with the header.
What?
My page is very nice with the
header. You want to show it here? Okay. Yeah, so for this part, what I did is just actually it's a plain text file. And if you try to like give a new line there, it won't work actually. You guys can give a try, it shouldn't work. For example, first line you say hi Rios, and second line you say hi your name, then the whole thing will go into the single row. It's because it's not HTML. For HTML to break the row, you need to do something else, and it will be covered in next session. Okay, let's have more fun. Yeah. So now, normally what I do is I will create additional terminal here. So I don't need to keep killing my application. Yeah. Come on. Yeah. But for now, let's, okay. If you guys can follow this one, so do Rails programming, I will normally have multiple terminal open, so I don't need to switch back forwards. And you can see for this one, when the server is running, there's nothing much you can do here. It's blocked by the server. But anyway, I'm going to kill this guy. Okay. So we covered all this. Okay, yeah. Next, I'm going to cover a bit on Rails command, and I'm going to talk about scaffolding. what does it do? It provides a basic structure to your model view controller. So this is the command structure. So you do real space generate space scaffold and space model name, and you give a list of attributes. I'm gonna come back what's the attribute. So after you run this command, actually Rails will help you to generate the data model you need, the controller you need, and the wheel you need. For beginners, normally this is a great starting point. So you don't need to really understand the relationship between each part of model wheel controller and how does it link it together. You can just start from there. So today, I'm going to do a name card model. So what this we're going to have after this is, you're going to have a way to create name card, delete name card, update name card, and remove name, yeah, I said delete name card, and listing the name card. And all this is just from a single command. Okay? Any questions to this part? No. Okay, if not, I'm continuing. So first, before we do anything, we always need to identify the attribute we need for our particular model. So what's an attribute? Attribute is just how to say that without talk about OOP. Yes, then how to talk about that, you don't talk about OOP. Okay, so anyway, a model can have key value pair, if you say. So for example, when you talk about name cards, you normally have what do you put on your name card? Given name, surname, company name, address, fax number, cell phone number, right? Something like that. And this each value put on the name card actually is the attribute. So does it make everyone more confused or? Okay, this is just some term we're going to use. Okay. For example, another example is menu. You're going to a restaurant and you see a menu. So what's the attribute will be on the menu? The name of the dish, the price of the dish, right? And if they want, they can put a picture. So the picture itself also can be an attribute to this menu. So it's similar here. Yeah. And so I put something else behind it. It's called data type. The reason we have this one is because we need let Rails know what type of data we want to put there. For example, for humans, numbers are strings when we talk about name cards. It's implied. So on name card, you see a string there. I mean, if you see a string after a cell number, you know it's a cell number. And the format, it just come to you. You understand what that means. But for programming language, we need to tell it what is it. For example, if you want to do a birthday management application, then you probably ask people put in their birthdays. Then you need to tell Rails it's a date time. It's a date time. Actually we have multiple data, not just your date. Okay? So same here. The reason I put everything using string is just simplify everything. So for sales numbers, you can put whatever you want actually in this case. And how to validate your data is a valid data is another session. So some point later, we're going to talk about how do you make sure the address is in the right format? How do you make sure the sales number is in the right format? Okay, but today we are not going to touch on all this, we just touch on the basics. Yeah. So if you go back to this part, is it here? Real Jarrett's Garfield model name and attribute, comma, attribute type. As you can see, the type is a part of our command. So here it is. And for type, we also have others like integers, reference, and we are not touching on this today. Yep. So for now, it's what we are going to use.
Why number is strings, not integers?
What if I want to put a space in my phone number? What if I want to put a dash in my phone number? What if I have international number? I start with a plus sign. And you know, for those people who travel to China and have a China number, they know in China, if you want to call like other states or that other country, you have 00 in front of it. If you put integer there, all this information will be lost. Right? So this is a part of identify model attributes. You need to think through what's this data type you need for your attributes. Okay? Questions? Okay. Let's convert the whole thing into a command. So, if something you need to pay attention to is, say the attribute name. What's that called? Snake case or something. So, for attribute names, I use I use an underscore to connect the strings. So for example, this one, company name, is a space, right? So I use an underscore. But go back to the model name, it's called camel case because it's like a camel. I use the uppercase for each word, connect this name without a space. Just pay attention to the little details here, and you should be fine. So start typing.
Oh, do we need to have this ESS?
Which one?
ESS. ESS
string.
Address.
Yes, you need type two still. Ah, there's something. Never mind. Just. I look sick.
What is ESS?
Okay, this will be hard for you guys to read. I will try to find something like. Of our attributes. Okay, so now we only have three, we don't need the rest. So now you can type the exactly word there. The reason being is, so two things. One is the space, it not really matters, but I don't want everyone confused about that part. But the enter, it really matters the new line character. So this whole thing should be in a single line. If you finish typing, just hit enter. Okay, I assume everyone have done this. So, my mind is so slow. Okay, so one thing, you can see it's generating a bunch of code for you. So, let's see about the code list. So the highlight part is the code generated by the command you just key in. Okay? So one thing here is you notice you key in the model name is camel case, not this guy, model name card, and it's being converted to a snake case here. But actually, if you double click open it in the file, you actually can see your camel case again. It's just some convention Rails use. So it's convention. So we don't really like do something about that. So the command did is just create this stuff. And another way for you guys to do the same is actually you can create all those files individually one by hand. Then just follow this naming convention. like snake case, and the snake case with the model name and with the controller, and the wheel will be a folder, and with each part of this file, you just follow the convention, and then the whole thing will just work. But since it will be a lot of tedious repeater work, we just use the command, okay? Okay, next, migration. Actually, if you go in on the that sidebar, if you go into there, under the database, you can see this folder. And we actually have a new file created. It's called a migration file. The reason we have this one is because the underlayer for Ruby on Rails is using SQL database. And just for your information, for SQL database, every time you want to add a new model to it, you need to change the database schema. Schema is just the structure of the data organized in this database. So that's why you have this migration file. It will help you to change the schema of the database. Okay.
So some of the things that you took away that you didn't want us to put in, we could later put those in.
Yes.
And run a migration.
Yes.
And it would.
Yes.
So, but it's not straightforward. Actually, you need to write another command to do that.
Oh.
Yes.
So first I would write a command.
Yes, so I can't remember the details, but you need generate a migration file. So it's a Rails generate migration and with a file name like adding attribute. So you give us attribute list.
So then I would name surveying.
Yeah.
Okay.
But those we won't cover today, we'll cover it later. Yeah. And again, since you're going to change the model, actually some of these files need to be changed too. Yes.
That's would I have to go in and change those by hand?
Yes.
Oh.
Yeah. So that's why it's great to get started with the scaffolding command. But for more advanced tasks, you still need to understand the relationship between these files. Okay? So, any questions about our migration file, little migration file? Next, I'm going to actually change the database with this migration file. No more questions, right? Okay. Okay. Update the database. I use DB, so database schema to the latest migration. Run this command. Rec space DB comma migrate. Just key in this command ER terminal and key.
It aborted.
What? It shouldn't.
Oh no. Stella, I'm sorry.
Now we have a schema file.
Yes. Then you will have a schema file, then you can take a look at schema file. I should show you the what's in the migration file later.
We are running out of time.
Okay, everyone, just key in this and hit enter. See that? So everyone is done. So now, if you're going to DB folder and the schema, you actually can have this part. You're going to see this quadrant here. It's almost the same as you input in your command. So, just a few things. If you guys know SQL, it's great. If not, just for information. This model name is also is your database table name. And then is your attributes. giving name, fax, sales number, and you can see the data type in front. This last two is added by Rails itself. So you actually have a timestamp information. You can see your own. It's the same, everyone should have the same. Okay? So, here is what we are going to do next. Run application. Okay. Everyone, after migration, run application.
If I want to add two more attributes to the same table, so I just do the same command as just now?
No, it will be different.
Add.
I have to do a false function.
You can do that. Don't do that. So, okay, migration. One thing you need to be careful is, now we are doing development, so it's okay. But imagine if you have production. So you need to be careful how do you migrate your data. For example, for some days, this particular field is not required. And some day later you decide, okay, I need this field to be compulsory for everyone. So what happens to the old data which doesn't have this field? So, it's a part of data migration planning. You need to really think through the functionalities between version to version and do the migration. But this is only for production. We're still doing development, so we can do a lot of crazy stuff, like we can just delete the whole thing and restart, right? Okay.
Hey, what do we create the page for?
We just did. Okay, let's I'm going to ask you later. So everyone, guess your application running, right? So everyone should have this page. Okay. Go to your URL. Okay, I will use the proper. I can't type with my hand. Go to your URL and add slash name underscore cards and hit enter and tell me what do you see. Do you guys see this page? Then you can start play around with it. You can click on the new name card. Then you can have a form. Fill it up. And click on create. Oh, I just created an empty one.
Wait, what were we supposed to key in?
Oh, in the URL?
Is it first day?
What? Sorry? That was my URL. This URL is generated by cloud. You should use your own URL. Go to cloud line. So, everyone got your name card. You can just key in your stuff. Let me do A. Number. Okay, now. If you notice that I create an empty entry here, the reason is we don't have validation. So you can pretty much do anything you want. Okay, I delete that. Yeah, let's delete that. Everyone got this one working? Anyone have questions?
Can we do list the events, or we don't use the name?
Okay, then.
Is this going to be on everything?
Right? You can. It can be a homework.
Exactly the same process.
Oh, yeah. So.
Why?
你刚才问我是什么时候 create 的 new page 是吧？那个 page。
我想说，我们只打了一个 command new name，为什么它就自动 generate 那些 page？
So, the question is why there is so many page created just after a single command. The answer is, it's this command's job to create these pages. Yes. So it simplifies the development process. This is another reason why Ruby on Rails is a good starting point. So you don't need to have a lot of information or a lot of knowledge. You can start with what you want immediately. Yeah. But for more advanced features, for example, here, I can create a name card without any value or without name. It's clearly wrong for a product, which means we need to add data validation in this process. And we will commit in the future.
Okay.
Yes. And again, you might feel this page is ugly. There's nothing amazing going on there. And it's not user friendly, so then it's a part of future discussion again. Questions? This is all I have for today.
Okay.
Yeah, so. Questions? Yeah.
Okay, I can't get this page.
Oh, we can't get this page. Oh,
okay.
Can you show us how to add the one more attribute just on this? Is it different?
Yes.
Is it different?
It's not really difficult. So.
You can just type there.
Okay, let me. Oh, there's my phone. Okay. Where's my So first to add a new attribute, normally I will do Rails generate migration. Then I will change the migration file and see no one is interested.
I'm interested.
Okay.
Who is interested in adding new attribute?
Okay.
Raise your hand.
What do you just add?
Come here.
Yeah, you can go there and teach.
Okay.
What?
Yeah.
The what?
Reels.
The recorder is now in the camera. Okay.
Yeah. Reels generate migration.
Yeah. So then you can give the migration name.
For example, address.
Okay. Then I will just call it add.
Address
to new. Add address to name cards.
Yeah.
Every time I was running this app, Control C and to stop the application.
Okay. So. Then you go to your migration file. Then you can see it's here. Then I can't remember the command. Let me see what else. What's the command? I can't.
Table name. You can Google for this one.
Yeah. See.
Basically,
So,
I just say one more time.
Just one second. So that's actually some people said terminology is not important for starters. Actually, I disagree. I think terminology is extremely important. For example, as just now we said, we want to add a new attribute to this table, and we don't really remember what's the exact command there. So you actually need the terminology to get there. The terminology is reverse migration at column. Column is a database term. Attribute pretty much it well works, but just try to remember terminologies and try to use it in when you do the exercise. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So another thing is you need to know how to read documents.
That's why I don't
copy. I already found it.
Okay, you find it. Then you can show us how to do it.
Okay, let's do it.
Yeah.
I don't know
what
I'm right
about. I can correct you. I mean, let me get my browser. Okay. So, now this guy. Okay, this guy. So, introduce yourself. So.
Hi, I'm Wesley. I'm going to show you that how to add a new column to this table, right?
Yes.
So, firstly, go to Google.
Migrate, add
new column. And then you come to this first record page, keep searching what is add, and you find something related to add. Just now I found it on my...
Okay, I will do my own Google.
Okay.
Alright, so if you don't know how to do it, you just search at it. And then until you find something really, okay, I think this is the part. And so what does this mean? That if you want to create a new column in your existing schema, so you could generate migration and then you'd add a name to this migration. You can name it in any way you want. And then the exact code, if you want to add a new column, you add the column name and the type of the column. So we just copy this part to this one. So you just copy it here, change it to add a address, email address there. Add a company name. And then the name of the attribute is called a company name. Company name. And the type is string. So then what would you enter?
You actually don't need a B.
So it's Rails general. So, and then...
What's next? So you have a migration file, so the next you should run the migration command. So the migration command is...
Rk.
it will take some time. It will be much faster on your own machine. So okay, say you see the migration log, and now you go into your schema. You can why is not there? Let me start. This is weird. Anyway, another way to do that.
Let me see.
I think Jerry migration coming. You didn't specify which table.
Okay.
Look at the file. No. The command here. It doesn't specify the table.
Right.
It didn't specify the table.
Yeah. Okay. See, you look at the file. You look at the command. You say add part two, add part number two, products. So what it's trying to do is look for the last item here, products, is actually a table. It's look for a table called products.
So you mean the name must be
match.
Yeah, your folder, your database table name, in your case it's called name cards.
Yeah.
So it should be add company name to name cards. Yeah, so change company to move.
Yeah. Okay.
Add company name to name cards.
So.
So there are no spaces between add company name to name card.
No. And if you give space, it will do weird stuff. Yeah. So. This itself is a parameter, its own.
Yeah.
And that has to be a camel, all of that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. I think it should be name cards.
Or name card.
Name cards.
Yeah.
Name cards. One more time.
Okay, when you're doing that, you actually create a lot of migration files you don't want.
We'll do it one at a time.
Yes.
Okay, then you look at the last file.
Yeah, I'll refresh this one. So try this one. I don't think so, this one is correct. It's still trying to figure out.
Yeah.
So real says please summarize.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So you create, in this case, I accidentally created a couple of different files. If you have not run migration yet, you have not run rate migrate, it's fine. Then just delete the old stuff which is not supposed to be there.
Just delete.
Except the last one as you want. Keep the first one as well. You don't want to delete the first one, right? So you probably create a review here.
Yeah.
If they are sorted chronologically as in the last one you create, you know, so you just delete the one that you don't need. Just keep the first one. Yeah.
So for that syntax, add the company name card, the capital doesn't matter, does it?
It should matter. It's what you want camel casing on my brain. Okay.
For the folder name cards, they are both in a small letter. Yeah, Rails will kind of convert that whatever you have in camel case into underscore. So like the page will convert it underscore. Yeah.
And so
I
just run the
migrate.
I just deleted
the
rest.
Yeah. And it should work. Hopefully.
Then I should go to.
Hopefully.
Ta-da. Yeah, it works.
In the migrate
folder, got
three files.
So okay.
One is
at
company
and the other is
at company. So we have to do those
kind of
separate files.
Okay. Yeah. So think of each migration file as like a, I'm remembering what I changed. Each of these files, when you create a migration. A migration is like I'm going to make a change to the database in some way. I'm going to add a new column, new attribute there, or adding stuff there. Right? So what it does is it takes every step of the way as you make changes to the database. Each migration file remembers what was changed.
So those files are the gem files.
No, those are just migration files. They kind of remember what you changed, so that you can actually. Oh, I did something wrong. I want to undo what I did. You can do that. You can just tell the database, look, I don't want the last change. You can actually roll back. And that's the process of undoing your last thing is in database terms, it's called roll back. Rolling back something that was, yeah. So each time you do a migration, it creates a new file. And the final structure, how your database will eventually look like, you can look under the schema file. Remember, look under slash db slash schema.rb. You open that file, you should see the final form of your database. Yeah. You look under, I think it should be under app, config db, oh wait, there's a db folder. There should be a db folder. In that db folder, there's a schema.rb. Do you see it? If you have run any migration, have you run migration yet? Yeah, you should see a schema.rb there.
But
you
show the page.
Oh,
you modify.
I didn't
okay.
I think Michael continue. Huh? Why we want to see the field on the page. Now it's on the schema.
Did everyone try to create a new column in your database? Yeah. Did everyone try to run a migration? Like Rick, db, colon, migrate? Yes? Great. Added the database table, right? So what happens when you run scaffold? A lot of Rails magic happens, right? We see a lot of files are created. So when you run Rails scaffold, it generates a whole bunch of files for you, which basically has the HTML layout for your for listing the list of name cards, adding name cards. Have you guys tried to add name cards and stuff? Have you ever tried that? You just go to your preview page slash name cards. There's a link at the bottom that says add name card. Just click that, you'll be able to see you can add new name cards. Everyone try that? Right, so the Rails magic that happens when you run Rails generate scaffold is that it generates all this information for you. But the problem is when you add new columns, like what we just did, that magic doesn't kick in. Right? So there's some magic that Rails do and some magic that you have to actually do yourself, right? So which is why we people need programmers like us.
Okay, so
there are a few things you can do. First, you can probably add the field. to your database, to the first thing, add the field that you just added to the HTML. Yeah. So one way to do this is to look under your views folder, under slash apps, slash app, slash view, right? In your name cards folder, you should be able to see a file called form.html.erb. You see that? Yeah, so you open that file, you should be able to find. Okay, so over here, this is HTML, right? But it's a different type of HTML called ERB, which I shall not go into right now. So what's the name of the field that we added? Do you remember?
Address.
Address.
No, company name.
Company name, right? Okay, so let's take one of these.
Sorry.
Oh, okay, cool. So you copy here. So right now, let's change this to company name. And below that as well, company name. Right, so you just copy one of your fields, maybe your cell phone field, just so basically the few lines, right? Four lines of code. Copy it down. How? Yeah, copy it down to the next section. And then you can rename it to company underscore name. Is that what you guys added? You guys added the company name, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So just do this first.
I have an email.
All right, you have email.
Do your thing, right? Do your thing.
You know what you're doing, right? All right, so next we have, okay, so once you have the form, you can actually see how it looks like, right? By just going to back to the web page, your app, and maybe you click on, right? So you click on your, you go back to the web page and click on new name card, you see the new company name form field there, right? Then you're not done yet. You're just adding the field, but it's not being committed to the database yet, right? So that's the second step, right? The second step you need to do now is to go back to the editor, right? And then I'm trying to remember where it is. The view is here. Okay, so let's try and add it into the database, right? So when you do models name, let me just check whether I can actually add this to the name. Oh, okay, it should work. And so yeah, let me just figure this out a little bit. Okay, right, so next thing you do is, yeah, go to your controller. Okay, next thing you need to do is go to your controller, name card controller. Okay? Right, so go to your name cards controller. Now I need you, this one takes a bit of scrolling, right? Let's go all the way to the bottom. Right, so the last part that says private and set name, blah, blah, blah. Okay, last piece of information here, name card params. Okay, so I need you to put next thing you do, put a comma, with a colon, followed by the company name. Right? Okay, you see that? Scroll down on your name cards controller, scroll all the way to the bottom, you see something there, it's called name card params. Okay, so now add the word name. So the semicolon in front is very important. Just remember to put your semicolons there, okay? In Ruby speak, that's called a symbol. Yeah, you're creating a symbol. Will it not? Okay, cut it off. All right, so what does this do? Okay, so in the first place, when you create, we have edited your form HTML, it appears in your new form, right? But you will try to create submit, you will try to submit to it, it doesn't actually add to the database. Why? It's because in Ruby on Rails, the controller file basically protects you from illegal stuff. It protects you from things that shouldn't be going into your database. So the way that we do that is to update this permission. Look, I allow the form to give me a certain piece of data. And the piece of data I want is the name, the complete name, okay? So right, so we can now try to add that in. Let's go back. So remember, save your file. Go to my name cards. Let's add something, right? And then company name, hello world. Limited. I see one display. Yeah.
Display doesn't work.
Does it still display? It doesn't display yet, right? Sorry lah. I mistaken. There's one more step.
The form is displayed, but when you add it, it's not. Yeah.
So you can still see it by clicking on edit. Yeah, you click on edit, you see the form view there. Right, the new record you just added. So there are a few things you do. Add it to the form, allow it to go through in your controller. And the last part is, when I go back to the home page, I want to see it here. Right, so let's show it here first, in your home page, in the name card's home page. So to edit that, we need to go back to the editor and look for a file called index. I think it's under your views. There is an index.html.erv, open that. Right? And okay, there's a few places you need to change. So let's look at line number 10. You look at line number 10, or rather, wherever you're. Okay, so index.html.erv under views, name cards, index.html.erv. You see that file?
Yeah.
All right, so let's add this thing here. You copy the line above it. So the last line before the word column span tree, don't do that. Just the one above it, copy that file, copy that line rather, select it, Command C or Control C, and Command V to the next line, and change that to company name. Okay? And there's one more line you change, just scroll down. You scroll down a little bit further, you will see that there's something here with name card dot cell phone or name card dot whatever, right? Copy that line as well. The entire line from TD all the way to TD, right? Copy that line as well. Put it down to the next line. Okay, the place you need to change, I'll be very specific here. So what do you think this means? Name card dot cell phone, name card dot fax, name card dot given name. What does this dot come? What does this mean? Okay, so name card dot, I'm going to show you the cell phone number. Name card dot fax, I'm going to show you the fax number, all right? So what is the next combination here that we need to show? What do we need to show? Company name, correct. So we change company name. So name card dot company name. This is very specific in small letters, everything in small letters. Okay? Right, so once you've done that, save the file and go back to the My App, your page again. You can refresh. Can you see it? Right, so let's recap. What did we do? So we basically went to the index.html.erv. Right, we added one more line there to say company name. And above, and just below it, where we're showing off all the different numbers and whatnot, was add one more company name. Okay? Not showing? Coaches, can you just help her with her problem? Yeah. Is everything, is everyone show this? Yeah. Is anyone not showing up? Is anyone having problem with showing this? Company name in your index view. Anyone else have problem? Okay. Sweet. Alright, so there's actually one more place you can do to actually make it show up completely, right? So right now we've seen all, we've added it to the form, we've added it up, but one place is still missing. Where is it? It's a show. You click on show, it's still not there, right? So Rails do so much magic for you, and now you have to go in and do more work, okay?
Yes.
Yeah, this is normal. All right, so one more place you change. So you look at So what are the files we have changed so far? We have changed the form.html. We have changed index.html. So what is, because now we're doing a show, what do you think is the file that we change? Show.html, correct. Let's go back there. Can you find show.html? Alright, you see it? Right, show.html, double click on it. Right, so right now, if you scroll up, you see, oh, it's showing me given name, it's showing me fax number, blah, blah. Oh, hey, it's missing a company name, alright? Let's just add that in as well. Right, you can copy the four lines. Like, say, the cell phone number, so just copy these four lines, copy it. Go into the last place, last line. Let's give it a right label. This will be company name, right? So company name. Right? And just below it, hey, it's the same card syntax. Yes, a name card dot something. Right? So what should it be now? Company name, right? Let's try that. Okay. Right, so you added this last line there, just above the edit link. Alright, so when you're done, remember to save your file and then refresh the page. Can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah, so let's show you again the show.html. So yeah, the last four lines as added in. And you shall be able to see the company name. Great. So if we click on that, right, you should see that, oh wait, the first few things is missing your company name. You know, you didn't get added. You had them before, so we click edit. Right. Okay. Did everyone reach this point where you can actually see the new field in your little application? Alright. Anyone else any more? No? Yes? All good? Yeah. So the Rails scaffold actually does a lot of magic for you. But the magic only ends at a certain point. So at that certain point where you change, where you need to make additional changes that Rails doesn't know how to help you with, right? That's where the magic ends, and you have to then do your own magic, right? So that's where you need to learn the right code. It's deliberately complicated, as in there's many places you change, because Rails gives you the flexibility to add new design and color and whatnot to the different pages. Right, so which is why they're...
Perhaps a question. Why some of the page appeared under views and some of the page appeared under public? I mean, some of the HTML page or ERB, HTML, ERB are in views, some are in public for the
right. The way that Ruby and Rails work is that you will look at it looks at the controller and say, what is the controller name? Okay, the controller name is name cards. And name cards, because when I want to show name cards, I want to load something first. When you go to slash name cards, what does it look for? It looks for the first page to load. The first page to load when you go to name_cards in your browser. So if I come here, name cards, what does it do? It's looking for something to show you, right? Okay, the first thing I try to show you is what we call an index page. An index page in the world web is basically the first page that loads. In some web servers, it's homepage.html or something. But in our case, it's looking for index. So what it does, in what Rails kind of do is look for the index method. You look under here. And then you also look for the index HTML file inside your name cards folder. And that's where it kind of loads the view, right? So that's the magic that kind of Rails kind of do. If you look for a controller, if I need to show something, I will look for the view file inside the view folder. Okay? So it looks for a file that's according to the name that you use. Okay, so if you look for, if I want to see something else, say I want to go to the show. So a link, where I link to say show, it goes to
which part determined that the index HTML is the first page to show if I type name?
Yeah, Rails does that for me. Rails is the one that determines.
So as long as you name it as index something, you will show it.
Yeah. Well,
the first page.
It's a little bit more complicated than that. There's another file that tells you how it does that, but I think we can go into what we call routing. This is the topic called routing, which we'll deal with next in the lecture. Yeah? All right.
So,
we actually cover way more than I planned today. So actually the name card should be the last one. And the ID attribute part is just a bonus part. So I think we're going to revisit this next time. And yeah, and the last song. So deal with passion, code is love.